is the Lightning Junkies podcast with your host, Chaz. On this week's episode of the podcast, we have Richard Myers, and we're talking about Lot 49 and L2, maybe some other stuff.
Before that, a message from your friends at the Lightning Junkies podcast. If you feel like this podcast is a value in your Bitcoin Lightning journey, please consider supporting us by listening to us on Breeze Wallet or any of the other value for value apps at newpodcastapps.com. For other ways to support the podcast, please visit lightningjunkies.net/support. There you will find the places to listen to the podcast as well as ways to support us with Bitcoin over the Lightning Network. Help keep this podcast ad-free and support us however you can. Now on with the show.
How are you doing today, Richard?
Doing great. Looking forward to the chat.
Fantastic. So, you know, a while ago, I can't even remember now, I think maybe in 2018, 2017, maybe even 2016, I can't remember how old Gotenna is, but I picked up some Gotennas because they seemed pretty cool. At that point, you were not working for them yet, I don't believe, and I don't believe Samurai Wallet had released their Mule Tools stuff yet. I think it was just before they did that, so I think in 2016. But I remember writing a article on yours.org, if anyone wants to make fun of that for a moment. But I was writing an article on there about the kind of idea that Samurai Wallet ended up building out later of copying Andreas Antonopoulos's idea from a YouTube video he had called The Long Arc of Technology or something like that. Basically kind of laying out the different ways that you could, you know, possibly use Bitcoin in a more adversarial environment. So Samurai kind of created this tool that would allow you to, you know, transmit your raw Bitcoin transaction over a Gotenna and transmit it, you know, out amongst the mesh network there. So bringing you on, I think, makes a lot of sense because it seems like this is what you've been working on is kind of the next logical extension of that, you know, being in an adversarial environment and, you know, having ways to, you know, run Bitcoin and run the Lightning Network and not necessarily need to have internet yourself and have ways of kind of working around that. But before we jump into all the nitty gritty of all that, I would love to hear how you first got started on Bitcoin and kind of what draw you into that, into this world here.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think my story for Bitcoin generally is like most people, you know, you read about it at some point and it sort of marinates for a while. And then, you know, just that interest continues to grow. But specifically about Gotenna, it's interesting. I was just actually going back and trying to get the dates right here. But I would say my first sort of contact with Gotenna was, I think I saw an article on Twitter or maybe in a post or something about them on Twitter. And at about the same time, I saw a post from Nick Szabo where he was talking about this idea. And he says, for ideal security, every node would talk directly with every other node. But short of that, mesh networks plus wide area broadcasts, like he was commenting on the Blockstream satellite, which was August 2017 when they announced that. And so I sort of put those two together and I commented about Gotenna, and they sort of responded back in a positive way that they agreed that sort of Gotenna would all, you know, would sort of fit for that kind of use. So I guess that sort of kicked it off. And from there, I actually began a discussion on first their discussion board and then eventually with their CEO, Daniela Perdomo, about this idea. And she was very interested in it. And she had an interesting, see if I can find the quote she had here. She said I don't have the exact words she said, but it was basically this idea. She was very intrigued by the idea of a protocol sort of incentivizing its own use. So that was sort of the way she was looking at it. And I mean, it happened that Gotenna was also accepting Bitcoin quite early. But what she was really interested in wasn't, you know, was sort of this overall idea that a protocol, in this case, Bitcoin, actually incentivized its own use. And I guess you could see that sort of being the miner infrastructure got built up and the, you know, people, the software development infrastructure, you know, sort of organically formed. So anyway, those discussions matured over time, and I did some sort of write-ups of ways I thought Bitcoin could be used to incentivize and basically solve a problem for Gotenna, which is how do you get people to run relays? How do you essentially get people to leave their Gotenna mesh device on for other people to relay and try to build out this network? And it's a hard problem. She talks about it as a zero start problem. Every network has this problem. Even Bitcoin, you could say, had this problem until you had somebody to send Bitcoin to, you know, until you had your Hal Finneys. There's really no network. So that was the problem we went out to solve. And that eventually, you know, went on for a while. And, I was enthusiastic enough that I kind of quit my job. I've been working as a software developer for a long time, mostly C++. So I quit my job of 17 years or 16 years, I guess, at that point, and went to work for Gotenna to pursue this idea of creating a protocol that could be built on Bitcoin to incentivize people to create a mesh network. That was the sort of way it got started. From there, I did a few things. One is I can't remember if the Samurai guys had already been in touch with Gotenna. It was just about that time, though. So they had been working together, and I helped out with testing, and we ended up demoing it in Prague at the, I can't think of the name of the conference there, but it's the Cypherpunk conference that happens there in Prague in the fall. And that was sort of how it all got started. And I did two things. I mean, basically I had two jobs at Gotenna. One was to pursue this idea of a protocol. And I did a lot of research and, you know, looked pretty broadly at other ways people were doing this. And then the other part of it was to create prototypes, things like TXTenna, and support those rest of the community who wants to build stuff using Gotenna to further Bitcoin. So that was Gotenna. And I did that at Gotenna for about 3 years. And you could sort of see it as them funding Bitcoin open source development, at least in this narrow, useful niche for them, for about 3 years. That ended at the beginning of this year, but I'm very grateful for them to be so sort of farsighted. So that was a great experience.
So let's take a small step back here, just in case any of our listeners don't know specifically what Gotenna is. Do you want to briefly let them know what the actual device is here?
Right. So yeah, Gotenna Mesh. You can sort of think of it as a data walkie-talkie. So it's something that pairs to your mobile phone via Bluetooth and allows you to send basically an SMS message. And that SMS message goes from the Bluetooth to this little device. It sort of looks like a USB and a little oversized USB stick. And you can hang it on your backpack or hang it off your hat. And what it'll do is then broadcast over a radio, a long-range radio, much longer than Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, to any other Gotenna Meshes radios that happen to be in range. And if you can do it either as a broadcast where everybody will see it, or you just do it sort of a person-to-person. And then for them, it just shows up as in an app as a text message. So this is the idea here is if you're out, for instance, if you're out hiking in the mountains or some place where there is no mobile sort of cellular data or cellular connectivity, you can still use your phone to talk to other people. And that's probably its most popular use is for people who are sort of off grid to just keep in touch with other people in their party around. That's basically, and it's got a battery, so it's totally self-contained. It lasts about a day. And the range varies. It depends sort of how high up you are and, you know, if there's line of sight. It doesn't need line of sight, but of course it goes, our furthest range tests, I want to say it was something like 12 miles or something when somebody was up in an ultralight. So there was obviously very little interference between those ultralights. But I would say it's about more like maybe a few miles if you're in a more urban setting. But that's still substantially further than Wi-Fi, which is what most people are probably familiar with. And range is range and the ability to multi-hop. That's the other, those are the sort of two features that a Gotenna radio is really built upon. So one is it has much longer range than, you know, a standard example of Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. But also, if the person you're trying to communicate with isn't within one hop. They're not within one radio range. If there's a radio there, it'll multi-hop through that radio, and it can go, you know, arbitrarily number of hops. I think it's probably limited to 10 right now, but 10 hops will get you quite far. That will cover a very large area. If you have units, you know, if you have people running mesh units and having them available to do that relaying. So did I miss anything? You're a owner. Did I miss any key features there, you think?
I don't think so. I think you nailed it pretty well there. And I think you at least brought up something interesting in my mind here. Maybe it's a kind of a tangent, but, you know, the kind of GoTenna system being a kind of rough analogy for the Lightning Network, is that going too far there, kind of stretching a little far?
I would agree with you. And that's why in the sort of research that I did early on at GoTenna, we very rapidly kind of like homed in on the Lightning Network is really the solution for this problem of incentivizing relays. There are some key differences, though. And one difference that's sort of interesting is we think about the Lightning Network while it's designed now. Sort of a lot of the technology that's gone into the Lightning Network is for privacy. This whole idea of onion routing, for example. And the reason for that is because just the way the internet is right now, you don't really have privacy. I mean, if you connect directly to another node, maybe you can encrypt your traffic, but the metadata of your IP address connecting to somebody else's IP address is something that could easily compromise your privacy. Just this, and this is like Snowden to reveal showed this for phone records, but obviously data records, it's even more true. But with mesh networks, you have a kind of a privacy advantage in that it's omnidirectional. So that sort of changes a little bit how you could do Lightning over something like a mesh network. Versus sort of the way we do internet right now.
So, you know, you're kind of working for GoTenna. Was Global Mesh Labs your kind of, like, I don't know how you structured this, but like, is it like your side company that you use to develop these technologies, basically Lot 49, and kind of get it out there?
Yeah, this is something that I was involved in. So I would say it wasn't until probably 2019, it was early 2019. And the decision was sort of made that it's really a branding thing. From a branding point of view, we had sort of two main customer bases at GoTenna. One is the commercial side of things, which is the, you know, the GoTenna Mesh, which you're familiar with. But we also sold and we're selling increasingly more to the government sector. So this would be first responders, you know, police and fire, but also military, border patrol, things like that. I guess for those customers, the whole sort of cypherpunk anarchistic things we were trying to do with GoTenna wasn't something that they were really interested in. So basically, rather than putting out a lot of sort of stuff under the GoTenna label, we created this Global Mesh Labs. That was sort of one aspect of it. But the other aspect of it was we wanted to expand beyond GoTenna from the standpoint of other vendors and other teams, basically. So it was always an open source project. So even though there are certain aspects of GoTenna, which is like the firmware and such, is closed source, all the software we built on top of it was open source. So Global Mesh Labs was also a place to sort of be a forum and a sort of place to house those open source projects and try to appeal to other even hardware manufacturers who might be making mesh technology. Because we really envisioned this something that, you know, we were trying to build something that other people would build on from a software and hardware standpoint. So we didn't want it to be too much branded with GoTenna for that reason. It wasn't just a GoTenna project. We wanted something that sort of could live outside of that. So, yeah, so I think that was the thinking behind making a Global Mesh Labs as a sort of a different moniker for what we were doing.
Maybe this is my kind of outsider's perspective, just kind of watching, you know, everything on Twitter or what have you. But I was, you know, kind of in around that time in like 2018, 2017, I remember looking at GoTenna and being like, it seems like the use cases are somewhat limited for the moment. I was, you know, looking at what people were doing locally. Like there were some people that are, I'm not going to say exactly where, but there are people that are, you know, taking GoTennas and similar devices, hooking them up to like amplifying antennas or something like that, and being able to push the distance of the transmission to be far beyond the normal scope, like in the inside of the city, like 15 miles or something like that, instead of, like you were saying, like 2 or 3 miles. Do you think that, you know, before we get into the nitty gritty of it, do you think that, you know, before we get into Bitcoin and Lightning, that the Gotenna is somewhat limited given the fact that there isn't this incentive yet for people to care about this stuff?
Yeah, I think you're talking about the what they called the Moan project. It was a great name. It's a mother of all nodes. So people were breaking these things open and putting, like you said, bigger antennas on it. You know, that's not something everybody could do. But there is a, you know, like I said, the sort of zero start problem, the chicken and the egg. Nobody, it's hard for it to achieve what it can, you know, even though it could hop 10 hops, generally people were going 1 or 2 hops at most. So a lot of the technology that was in these, that is in these devices isn't really, you know, used to its fullest. So until you get a certain critical threshold of people running these things, it's hard to say, you know, how useful it is beyond a small group. And that's sort of why the military customers, of course, they're obligated to run them, sort of, you know, what if you've got a team out there doing something, fighting a forest fire, they're all going to run their meshes. And so you get the full benefit. But if it's just ones and twos, and people don't have their mesh on at the same time, or they're not, you know, not doing that, you know, not kind of working together, then yeah, so it's hard to get the full usefulness out of a mesh network versus a centralized network. I mean, your cell phone works. I like to compare this sometimes to how do you launch a cellular network? Well, there you just invest billions of dollars to build all of these towers so that everybody within a certain geographical area, when they turn on their phone, they get signal. But with a bottom-up network, a mesh network isn't top-down. There is no necessarily one entity that's going to deploy all this sort of, you know, buy up the bandwidth and deploy these units everywhere. It's got to come from the bottom up. So yeah, I think you really needed something like a incentive system for this to work. And it's, you know, what you're incentivizing isn't just people to be relays, but also people to be gateways to the non-mesh network. So at the edges, you'd like your messages to be able to travel further distances. Maybe somebody's got a satellite uplink, or they've got just an internet connection, so that if you send a message that to somebody who isn't in the local area, that it can keep going. So that bootstrap is really important. And there's another thing too that I kind of, you know, I obviously was a salesman for Bitcoin within the organization because I was sort of the only Bitcoin guy there. And one sales point, I think, for Lightning and Bitcoin in general is that you don't just get a really strong piece of technology, but you also get a community that's A, very enthusiastic. So your core seed community could be the Bitcoin community, because obviously this is a group that's enthusiastic about the promise of a decentralized communication medium. I mean, that's, you are an example because you bought one early compared to like sort of most people. So there's that, but you also get the technical community. So, and this has actually played out over the last 3 years, a lot of what I sort of proposed for Lightning, for how we would use Lightning, has been built by other people, has been built by, for instance, Sphinx Chat. We can get into that later. But this idea of communication apps using Lightning has really gone far without, you know, it being specifically built by Gotenna. This is just, you know, the rest of the community building it. So, yeah, so the community is a great seed community to get this network sort of jump-started. But also a technology community that is building it, if maybe for other reasons, but a lot can be repurposed. You don't have to start from scratch. And that would be contrasted. I mean, you remember 2017, 2018, that was the age of the ICO. You know, that the conventional wisdom is you create a token and then you get a lot of VC money and you pre-sell your tokens or you pre-sell the tokens. I forget the whole model, but I guess a lot of people did both. And then that's what you use to pay your developers to build the, you know, to build whatever it is you want to build. So going with Lightning wasn't the conventional way people built protocols, to build on top of an open source protocol. But I think over time it sort of proved out because of the longevity from using the existing Bitcoin technology is going to be far superior than some fly-by-night ICO approach to building a mesh network.
There's basically two questions that came from that. So the first one I would say is, again, I'm kind of getting reminded of the Lightning Network when you talk about mesh networks, because I feel like early on when Lightning was kind of more of a quote-unquote new thing, when it went, I believe, hit mainnet in 2018, most people, I think, at that point didn't really care about the Lightning Network. And then if you look at today, you have Plebnet, you have Rings of Fire, and these kinds of bootstrapping communities that are kind of emergent. I think let's not waste any more time here. Let's go ahead and jump into Lot 49 itself and begin to look at what it is itself here. So I definitely know about like basically everything surrounding Lot 49, but I know basically nothing about Lot 49 itself. Could you give me like a brief introduction, and then we can kind of get into the meat and potatoes of it and, you know, what it requires, why it makes sense, et cetera?
Yeah, I mean, you can really think of, Lot 49 is really just Lightning, but adapted to this use case. So the use case has sort of two main features that sort of standard Lightning may not have, although now has one of them. Is one is to make it a way to send essentially short messages over the Lightning network. So through a multi-hop network where every relay is receiving some payment for relaying the text of the message. So that's a little bit like the SendPay or the Sphinx chat sort of idea of Lightning. So that wasn't really existing when we started, but now it's really sort of taken off. So that's one thing that maybe the standard Lightning didn't have at that time. The other thing, which it still doesn't have, is a different, I guess you could say, different aspects that adapted for radio and not internet. And some of those aspects are things like making it low bandwidth. I would say most of my emphasis has been on, or most of the emphasis of the Lot 49 protocol is how do we make this as low bandwidth as possible? And part of that is to do different kinds of routing, because the routing is not like, it's not routing over an internet system. It's routing over a radio system where you've got one plus in that you don't have to worry about surveillance in the same way as you do over the internet, but has another aspect in that, you don't have fixed routes. The routes are sort of dynamically built. So yeah, those are the two things that basically Lot 49 does is to envision how to adapt Lightning into this radio network and then how to adapt it to incentivize the exchange of messages.
Would you say that Lot 49 is ready to rock today, or are there some technical things that need to happen first before it could actually be put into use?
Well, yeah, there's quite a lot that has to get done. We did a lot of tests, so that was sort of where we left it in 2020, I guess, was doing tests over different mediums. So one was doing it over the Gotenna mesh, but the other was doing it over things like ham radio. So ham radio is a really complementary technology because it's really just a lot more powerful long range version of a Gotenna mesh. We did things like some of these experiments we did were to show how low could you go as far as bandwidth. So how, you know, what messages do you really need? A good example of that would be, for instance, taking out the onion routing, because every packet of data you send is sort of over the Lightning network now has this 1300 bytes of routing information, which we didn't include because our messages were so small that that was basically kind of dominated the whole communication if you included it. And then around that, you know, we took out things like exchanging routing information as well. So you could say that Lot 49 uses, in some ways, it's more like a internet routing where you just pass it on to the next node near you, and then they send it to their next node, but you're not pre-computing the route. So we did a lot of experiments like that. But the next step, the step that we really needed to do next is to build all this into a mobile app, you know, that could talk to a Gotenna mesh, for example. And that's sort of where we're at now. There are some problems with that. So first of all, it has to run on a mobile phone. And I think, as you know, we're still sort of limited in the technologies that exist for building Lightning on mobile that is completely disconnected from the internet, so that you can do it with LND. You can't really do it with C Lightning. You know, now starting to see things like the LDK, for example, where you can more pick and choose which parts of Lightning you're actually running. So that is sort of our next step, is to, especially now that the Lightning development kit is in their sort of 1.0, would be to build an app and strip out the parts we don't want and add the parts we do that are specific to sort of running over radio. So I think that's probably a good summary of where we're at now with that.
Is that something that's going to go forward, or are you needing to kind of like raise money or get something else going in order to make that happen?
Yeah, well, I mean, the hope is that it's something that the community can help build. I don't see this as something that we would really raise money for. I mean, I suppose if there was a strong ecosystem, you know, demand for it, probably it would be something we could get grants for. So, I mean, that might be one way to raise money to get people to work on this. That's a possibility. I don't know. Working for a company like Gotenna, they were a VC-funded company. So I did talk to a lot of VCs about this. And unfortunately, the business model is not necessarily as attractive for those sort of non-Bitcoin funding, you know, not Bitcoin-focused people. It really has to be somebody who's really interested in funding sort of Bitcoin ecosystem more generally, I think, to see this happen. And I think those people do exist, but there's quite a lot we can do just with the development community as it is now. Like I said, you've got what's going on with SendPay, that, you know, that kind of technology. So there's a lot of parts of this that are happening, but maybe the radio part is the part that probably is a little harder to get started. Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely. I'm trying to dig in here and trying to understand better. I'm trying to think of like how things could possibly work if you stripped out, you know, A, B, C, X, Y, Z. Like, what are you left with? How does the system kind of cope with you kind of doing an end run around it in a way? So you're kind of talking about how you would kind of push like a lot of this work on to the next node and all that. Like, is that something that you would say is scalable? Like, are you just relying on people that have, you know, regular ClearNet Lightning nodes, for example, to do a lot of this kind of heavy lifting for these mesh nodes?
The nice thing about Lightning is that it's more like these communication protocols work as long as your peer is running the same protocol. So sort of the way I would envision this working is there's going to be a certain number of hops that are running a sort of lot 49 speaking to each other with this sort of stripped down version of Lightning, this lot 49 version of Lightning. But then eventually it will hit a node that's connected to the internet one way or the other, a gateway node. And from there, a payment would happen, basically send a communication, but also a payment would then happen using the normal Lightning protocol. So it has to stay compatible at the sort of HTLC level. So those are, that's sort of the minimum required functionality that has to be compatible. But the routing is the place where it's pretty much going to differ, and the minutiae of how each node communicates could also be different. In order to minimize communication, bandwidth. So yeah, that's sort of how I envision it working from a global standpoint. But you have similar problems that, you know, if you want to send to a node that's near you and they're offline, or they may not even be there, they might have walked away sort of. I think a hard hurdle is with mesh more than sort of internet Lightning or say radio Lightning versus internet Lightning is, the nodes will be a lot more ephemeral. So, you might have to open more channels or have a different system for that. So, so that's one area that is going to be sort of difficult. And the other is if you're using it primarily for messaging and you're dealing with very low payments. I know you've talked to Fiat Joff, I think, and he brings up quite often this idea of streaming very low cost payments. And that's something that, you know, we have to deal with when you're dealing with this sort of system. So maybe you're making payments for not just each message, but you're making payments for a series of messages, and then you're just sending those messages between hops. So yeah, so there's still quite a lot that needs to be sort of worked out, but the key is to get just a prototype out there so we can start sort of examining these issues. That's pretty much where we're at now. I mean, maybe that's just my own development system too. You can think about this stuff a lot in a sort of theoretical sense, but until you actually have a working app, it's really hard to figure out what's important, what technical hurdles are important. And I mean, you mentioned early Lightning. I would say that was certainly the case for early Lightning. I remember using it from the beginning and having a lot of failed payments, you know, almost, I guess, the majority being failed payments. Now I use it today and it's just no comparison. And that's just having it out there and having people being reckless is how you get these technical hurdles and figure out solutions to them.
So I just wanted to ask a bit of a silly question here. You would never probably see a routing node be a mesh network node. Am I right?
it could be. It would be a routing node for... What do you mean by a routing node? Maybe I'm not quite sure what you mean.
a node that specializes in being a routing node. So I would say that my Lightning node, for example, is meant to be a routing node. Well, my main one is, and say maybe my side one that I have here at home is meant for just payments, for example.
I see what you mean. Yeah. So there's sort of a terminal node, the one that you're just making payments from, but you're not expecting to keep on all the time, for example. That is, I would say, an important thing we're trying to incentivize is for people to actually run routing nodes. So that may be that it's your phone that you carry around with you, but it may also be that some people will put them in their windowsill. You know, they'll have a fixed node in their windowsill connected to power. And that is a person who's hoping to actually, just like your routing node, earn Satoshis for what they do by running that node. So yeah, I think absolutely. That's the goal, is to incentivize people to run these routing nodes. And a gateway is another kind of routing node. So that's somebody who's going to say, I'm going to be a bridge onto the internet for people. And I'm doing that because there's a demand for that, and I'll earn more Satoshis by doing that. But your terminal nodes, the ones that are just there to make payments, they might be sort of opportunistically routing nodes. When they're on, they'll be opportunistically routing. And you know, if it just sort of balances out, the messages they send earn them a certain Satoshis, and the messages they route earn them a certain Satoshis, maybe they just sort of net out. But if you're a clever router, you know, now like your routing node, it's which other peers you connect to, which channels you do, and your sort of liquidity management maybe is critical to being a good routing node. There's one other aspect when you're dealing with a mesh node is where are you located? So you might be in the busy in the middle of the city, or you're some, you know, in a mountain pass. People want to get over that mountain with their data. You know, there's different aspects that I imagine will be important for people running a mesh routing node versus somebody who, you know, having constant power versus somebody who's running a kind of current routing node for Lightning. That makes sense.
It does. I feel like it's a pretty easy picture for my brain to paint of a future where, you know, I have my node here at home. I decide to make it a mesh routing node by connecting, you know, my Gotenna here, for example, and, you know, just getting more interoperable, let's say, with the people that are kind of local to me and might want to make payments. But I would assume that if you're in the middle of a city, you're not going to have a great use case. You're going to want to be, you know, at the edges, you know, where, like you were saying, the kind of mountain pass sort of thing where, you know, it might have difficulty without you, let's say. So that seems like a very interesting future where people just have, you know, maybe lot 49 built into one of these node operator software packages, like my node Umbral or whatever, and just have that be something that they do out of the box. It's very fun to think about.
You could also think about, like, you've got a Wi-Fi router, and maybe you've plugged in your Gotenna mesh to your normal Wi-Fi router. You know, that's your mesh node now. So people who connect, you know, who are nearby, maybe they connect over Wi-Fi. People, and then you're connecting from there further to your other cohorts that are, you know, that are connected via the Gotenna. So those are going to be longer range connections for those. So there's a whole lot of things, and maybe there even could be, you know, I don't know if you're familiar with this project called Althea. They build, and there's a new NYC Mesh, there's a bunch of these that build Wi-Fi networks, and they have their own token, Althea does, unfortunately. But you could easily do this with Lightning too, where you're just paying for these sort of fixed connections, these long range, but Wi-Fi fixed connections. So it'd be like, you know, you're not just paying for an SMS message, maybe you're paying for data, you know, like a real data connection, a real internet connection, but you're just paying with Lightning. And the real difference there is that it's anonymous, it's subscriptionless. And so you could imagine somebody who just walks by and connects via, you know, via a hotspot. And as long as they're able to pay via Lightning for the data they use, boom, you know, they're there without any sort of prior subscription. So that's another thing that you can do sort of with the same technology.
All right. I just wanted to ask, would L2 make Lot 49 better in your eyes or more usable for mesh networks?
In my sort of early research of this, and especially with this idea of reducing bandwidth, I looked a lot at what was required for the current Lightning implementation and had read the L2 paper when it first came out and came to believe that there are ways that you can do sort of these L2 payments in a way that's much more bandwidth efficient or you know, much smaller. Now, of course, L2 is still evolving, so some of these things may or may not end up to be true, but I was looking pretty broadly, but it definitely simplifies the network. that's also kind of useful in this scenario to simplify the way those sort of symmetric payments are working. And there's just various features of L2 that I think would be very useful for this kind of communication. I mean, I don't know if I should get into the really sort of technical nitty gritty, but one thing that I've talked about with others is that there is a potential way with L2 to send a payment where sort of imagine it's going in sort of one direction. You don't have to get the response like A is paying B and I send you my signature. I sign off on that update to the channel, but I don't need to wait for B to send me back a signature. I mean, B is getting paid, so I can rely on B to drop that channel information, to drop that update if it ever kind of gets to the network. And that isn't really true with maybe the way the Poon-Dryas system works now. You really need to have this sort of bidirectional, quite a lot of, you know, bidirectional communication in order to move on, you know, to say that state is confirmed and you can move on to the next state. But there are some ways that you can, and part of it is that you don't have the penalty if you send an old transaction, but part of it is the fact that you've got these symmetrical transactions. So the fact that, you know, A and B in an L2 channel are signing the same transaction and spending the same transaction if something goes wrong. But in the Poon-Dryas system, they're not symmetric. So A and B have different transactions that they'll drop if things go wrong. You know, I mean, at a high level, that's why L2 is better for a low bandwidth communication. And one other thing, I mean, I this is maybe a little more in the sort of sci-fi realm, but maybe not now that we have Taproot, is the idea of creating these idea of channel factories, so multi-party channels. So in the case of a mesh, imagine everybody you can communicate, you know, five or six nodes you can communicate with your radio, you could all be in a multi-party channel, for example. And that would mean that you only have one on-chain UTXO. So in the case of a expensive fee environment, you can do a lot more with that setup, which you can't do with the sort of Poon-Dryas system. You can't do multi-party lightning. So yeah, there are definitely some things that are better.
I would love to jump into channel factories here for a second. I think I was going to ask you about that, saying, you know, how would that work out for for Lot 49 here? But I find them fascinating. What I think I find the most fascinating is the fact that, like you were saying, you can have this big multi-party channel, but you can also have sub-channels on top of this kind of multi-party channel that are two-party channels, kind of virtual channels or sub-channels or whatever name you want to give them. Do you think this kind of flexibility that, you know, a multi-party channel, while I guess in some sense it might be more complicated and all that, but do you think it would provide more flexibility and more ability for people that are on these meshes to be able to kind of operate in a way that makes the most sense for them because they are on a mesh network? You know, they don't have all the advantages of someone like me that's, you know, that has it running in the cloud or whatever the case may be.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if you get any special advantages being in a mesh network. I mean, it's just useful for anybody who wants to not always have to settle to the chain. But because you are off-grid, maybe there is a slight advantage, because this is maybe the problem if you're in a true off-grid environment. So you're in a place, let's just say you're in, you know, Lebanon or Venezuela, where, you know, honestly, the internet can get just shut down for weeks. That means that if you do need to close a channel, you're going to lose your HTLCs because they will, you won't be able to get to the internet in time. But if you're only closing out one of your pairwise channels to a channel factory, well, as long as your channel factory partners are still around and still able to communicate over the mesh, you know, it gives you this sort of off-grid way to settle them out. Now, you still have the same problem if your whole channel factory needs to close out. Well, then you do have to get to the internet. At least you sort of in the back of my mind, the tentative way I see this working is your timeouts are something you can set. And the optimal timeouts are based on sort of what your internet environment is. If you can't reliably get to the internet on a sort of daily basis, then, or a weekly basis, then those timeouts are going to have to take that into account. But maybe your timeout for closing out to a channel factory will be shorter. And then the timeouts for sort of your pairwise channels will be even shorter still. So this is a sort of parameters we need to discover what works, but it gives you a lot of flexibility to make those trade-offs and not, I mean, that's usually the question people ask me when they talk about doing anything with Bitcoin over the internet or over the mesh is, well, you've got to have the internet. Because yes, you obviously do have to have the internet, but Lightning is a way to defer that. And deferring that also means you're deferring your need to access the internet. And I see channel factories as just one further way to defer that need to go on chain and to actually hit the internet. I think it could be useful for that reason for sure.
Would you say that you like the idea of channel factories in general, or maybe said a different way? Do you think that the potential issues with channel factories, maybe their complexity, their trust factor, et cetera, won't be as big of a deal in reference to the things that channel factories would give us?
Well, I mean, I think all the downsides are probably still there. I mean, you still have this problem that if your peers in the channel factory aren't available to sign off on an update, you know, that's going to cause you to hit the chain again. So, and so that'll have to evolve. But it creates another reason to use channel factories. That's what I would say is you've got this reason of just deferring getting on the internet as being one other reason. So I think that just incentivizes people to play nice because they want to keep the channel factory because they have this sort of group that is able to do things without the internet.
Before you had kind of mentioned what I guess you were calling pay messages, if I remember correctly, when describing like Sphinx Chat and related chat messaging programs. Do you want to kind of briefly let me know what you mean by that, by pay messages?
Well, it's basically using the Lightning Network as a incentivized messaging protocol. So this is what Sphinx Chat uses it for in some ways. The key there for mesh networks is just a way for these routing nodes, what we talked about earlier in the gateway nodes, to earn some satoshis for forwarding messages, but not just for forwarding payments, but for actually forwarding text. So that in the case of sort of the current protocol is wrapped into the onion that's sent along. We would probably do it somewhat differently or maybe not. I mean, we probably do it somewhat differently over a mesh network. Although if we're routing differently, then you wouldn't put it in the sort of routing packet. The idea is very simple. It's just that, you know, I'm a routing node and I will collect an HTLC if the data that I was sort of promising to, not just the payment, but if the data I was promising to deliver is delivered. So that's the whole concept right there.
I really like the idea of being able to have, you know, these mesh devices and have them in case of an emergency, have them for, you know, potentially routing, et cetera, et cetera. Do you think, I mean, I think the answer is yes before I even ask the question, but do you think it's going to be a very difficult time to actually pitch this to anyone that doesn't already care about mesh networks or Bitcoin or Lightning in general?
Yeah, I mean, for sure. In the Western world, you know, we have very good data and, you know, data connectivity, and we don't often, you know, actually hopefully never see our internet shut down for political reasons. But just like Bitcoin, I think where we're going to see more interest is going to be in places where those aren't things you can count on. Like recently I was talking to this Lily from Lebanon. And there's a lot of interest, you know, she was very interested in doing this in a place like Lebanon because, you know, they don't just have necessarily political censorship, but they also have power outages. And they have a lot of reasons why sort of bootstrapping a Bitcoin economy in this really damaged country is going to be more challenging. And Venezuela is another place that, you know, that could be useful. And they worry, you know, the big worry there isn't just that you may run out of power, but, you know, you've got other problems in that, you know, like maybe these devices aren't allowed. So, there's both reasons it could happen in those places and reasons that it's challenging just for the reasons that they're having these problems. But I think that's the appeal in those places is a lot more sort of immediate than they are here in the Western world. But of course, we're much wealthier here. So that's the other reason that people are able to sort of bootstrap it and sort of play around with it. And there is a lot of interest in Bitcoiners. I mean, when I talk to people about this, people who are, you know, really understand the threat model of Bitcoin, you know, they want it just like they want to run Blockstream satellites. They also want to run a mesh network. And I think we'll see development in both places, both, you know, sort of developing countries where they have a lot of problems and also in the Western world, but mainly around enthusiasts who are doing it more sort of from an altruistic standpoint, just like, you know, the reason people run Lightning nodes initially was more and probably still a little bit more for the altruistic reason and just creating that. You don't necessarily need full coverage for these things to have an effect to resist censorship. If you have enough, it's almost like the threat of an alternative network is in some ways enough to prevent the censorship that you're trying to prevent. Just because, like, if you could imagine in Hong Kong, if there had been a robust mesh network, the authorities would just know they couldn't shut off the internet. Then they wouldn't shut it off because they know that it would be ineffectual. Yeah. So those are factors that go into sort of how willing people are to run or to experiment around with this stuff.
Would you say that the Bitcoiners or what have you running these mesh networks might be doing it in order to prepare for a kind of adversarial environment that may or may not come into existence later on?
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah. That is the reason you would do it, is you would run it. You would run it for a future adversarial situation, but you would also potentially run it for your own privacy. I mean, obviously, the connections you're making over the internet could go through Tor, and this is sort of like an even more hardcore Tor. You know, if you actually are running over radio, if there isn't somebody sitting there with a snooper, even if they are, it's just going to be encrypted radio communication. They don't even know who you're communicating with, like, directionally. So, if you really want to go hardcore privacy, having alternative communication channels is very useful. I mean, just to give you a concrete example, and this is something that Bitcoin tries to fix in other ways, but, you know, you want to make a payment via even layer one Bitcoin. So not even talking about Lightning. There's a lot of technology that goes into Bitcoin Core to make sure that it's not obvious where that transaction came from, because you don't want a particular transaction to be associated with your IP address. So Dandelion is one technology used to sort of obfuscate where that comes from. But mesh could be another one. You know, if your transaction flies over the mesh and hops three or four times and then comes to an internet connected computer, then that obfuscates, you know, what IP address made that transaction. So that's the kind of day-to-day privacy that you can get. And for Lightning, you know, that's also true. Maybe having a few channels over mesh could help obfuscate, you know, give you something that isn't tied to your IP address, you know, if other things get sort of compromised.
After you developed Lot 49 and put it out there, you know, showed it off, I'm sure, what was maybe the internal opinion at Gotenna or, you know, about the stuff? Like, do you think that, I'm not sure about the CEO, but just people in general, you know, saying, oh, wow, yeah, this would definitely incentivize me to run a mesh device. Did you see much people kind of jumping onto the idea? Or was it just a general, oh, the cool, that's a cool idea, but never do anything kind of further than that?
Yeah, maybe more the latter. I mean, at least within Gotenna, I mean, like I said, I was sort of the primary, I mean, I was the only one who was really focused on this technology, although we did bring in some other people sort of externally. And everybody thought it was cool. And I think there were a few Bitcoin converts during my 3 years there. So internally, it was always sort of well supported. But as far as the sort of larger Gotenna user community, I think it was a little obscure. You know, like if you weren't a Bitcoiner to begin with, I think a lot of people weren't, they weren't focused on that, and they didn't really see the appeal. That was my experience. I mean, I still think we haven't quite solved this problem of how to kind of bootstrap people to do it, and it's a challenge. I mean, it's a challenge with any complicated technology. I think the only way to really solve it is to reduce it at least to a simple prototype that people can actually run without much effort. That's sort of maybe the next step for us, is to get something that you can just sort of one-click install on your phone, connect to your Gotenna, and then be part of this network in some way.
You had kind of mentioned before what the kind of next steps were. You need to get this app built and things like that. Do you have any kind of foundation laid out? So if I said to my audience here, here's an action item you can take to go ahead and make this project happen. You know, do you have any like a list of things that people could do to kind of encourage you or to encourage the project, kind of push it along, et cetera?
Yeah, I mean, I've got a few things on GitHub. So I think that's, you know, that's a place where people can contribute. I mean, that's the advantage of it being open source. And I should have mentioned this at the beginning, that I'm working with two other Bitcoin developers on this. And actually, the three of us got a grant from the Human Rights Foundation. So we have been supported by the Human Rights Foundation earlier in the year. So it's myself, Fodi Diop, and Will Clark. And we're working on different aspects of this, so the three of us. And I think, you know, Will is mostly working on the layer one part of it, trying to make low bandwidth sort of layer one transactions. And Fodi is working on the app side. And my thing is would be more on the protocol side. So this is the AnyPrev out and L2 work I've been doing this year. But all those projects could use more developers. So if anybody is, for instance, interested in Android, maybe they're mostly an Android developer and they're good at that. The Bitcoin side of it is sort of something we can fill in. And likewise, if you're more like interested in Electrum, that's one thing we've been looking at, sort of creating an Electrum interface over Mesh. That would just be a way to support the sort of layer aspects of the Lightning protocol over Mesh. So there is a lot of stuff. I don't have a good roadmap, but I would say anybody who's interested in this, I can certainly find things. And that's generally how it's worked. If somebody's interested, I'm just sort of the person if they see what I've done, then they get in touch and we usually talk and find some aspect that they're interested in working on and that would be useful to push this forward. That's it. I think if anybody's interested in, for example, building on the LDK, that's sort of the next phase for the Android app is to integrate that into this app that we have sort of prototyped out or sort of sketched out. So if anybody wants a sort of concrete thing they can build, that would be one thing. But I like that you asked this question because that's what we need is we just need more people who want to volunteer their time to push it forward. And there's so much out there already in the Lightning and Bitcoin community. It's mostly just sort of Lego blocking it together and then making a few changes. And that's, it takes time, but it's not like you have to build everything from scratch. There's quite a lot out there that we can repurpose. Just need to just spend the time to do it, basically, is where we're at.
So let this be a call to action for all those people out there that, you want to help in Bitcoin, you want to help on Lightning, you want to help with kind of privacy in general. Contact Richard, get on top of this Lot 49 thing, add whatever you can, even if it's just typo edits, on the GitHub. I'm not sure how much you would like that, but...
No, that's fine, yeah.
But just generally, like if you have some kind of design aptitude, I'm sure you guys could deal with some of those folks, maybe a little early for them. But regardless, I'm sure if there's anything you could do to help, contact Richard and I'm sure he'll put you to work for you.
Yeah, thanks. That's absolutely what we need. And that's how things get built in Bitcoin generally. So just need more of that.
Kind of reaching towards the end here, I wanted just before we moved on from Lot 49, I wanted to double check if there's anything else on Lot 49 we should hit before I go into more general questions here.
No, I think you hit most of it. Maybe we're going to get to this next or I can mention it next is in that sort of call to action. I've been working on trying to help push forward what we need for L2. So I took a look at what Christian Decker and AJ Towns have been doing and trying to implement that. So if anybody else is sort of interested in that, I really hope that's also something they'll get in touch about because we're at a really sort of exciting time for those proposals.
Yes. If anyone's been paying attention to my last couple of shows, they'll know that it's been pretty much me talking about AnyPrev out and L2 over and over and over again. Because, yeah, I think those are some of the most important changes and improvements since Taproot.
Absolutely.
I feel like saying this, and please correct me if you disagree, but would you say that BIP 118, AnyPrev out, is almost more important than Taproot?
That's a good question. I mean, it really, I wouldn't say it's more important. I mean, the more, I wasn't that up in Taproot when it first came out, and I had a lot of opportunities to, but looking at BIP 118, it's sort of forced me to really understand Taproot. And, it's really pretty dramatic, the things that it brings to Bitcoin, but it's all, it's all building on itself. So 118 is even more powerful because Taproot exists. I guess that's how I would at least phrase it. But, you're probably thinking of, I'm pretty narrowly focused on L2 and what L2 gets from AnyPrev out and Taproot combined is better than what we had when we only had SIGHASH no input, which is the sort of SegWit version of AnyPrev out. So that's why I think that, yeah, if you're looking at, yeah, you really got to look at it as a progression. That's how I see it.
Right. I would agree with you. I think I was just giving you a hard time there.
Yeah. But I do want to say one thing before I forget, and that, like, one thing that I promised you that I would announce something, and this is the thing I want to announce, is that I've managed to code up at least a very initial version of all the transaction types that you would need to do L2 with any prev out using the current BIP 118. So it's actually, you could say there's sort of a very early version of L2 possible now. This isn't just theoretical. And anybody who finds that sort of exciting, I will be putting out a blog post shortly that kind of describes my journey to try to do this and hopefully explain it in a way that other people can also be joining in on this, this journey to make both any prev out and L2 as sort of a 1-2 punch possible in the near term, I hope.
So yeah, just for reference, this is going to air in 3 weeks or so. So I'm sure you will have already posted this blog post. We'll have it in the show notes, but I'm sure we'll have already retweeted it and made it a big deal on our Twitter page as well.
Cool. Yeah, no, it's been a long time in coming, but I've learned a lot. And I think the only way to learn this stuff is to try to build it. That's the cypherpunk way, but it's also the pedagogical way to learn a lot of this Bitcoin stuff.
Yeah, I would agree. It's like one of the big reasons I decided to start a podcast is I was not able to mainline information fast enough. So I was like, well, let me just go try to talk to the experts directly and just interrogate them for an hour. And maybe we can learn a little bit faster and kind of get more involved here. Well, great. So I'm looking forward to reading that blog and seeing, what people do with that stuff and how we can expand this thing and get this thing moving a lot faster. Because I remember this thing like years ago and I'm like, damn it, whatever happened to Lot 49? I was super excited about that. Then it just faded. But like, as you've laid out here in this episode, I think it makes a lot of sense why it's not quite there yet and why we need a bit more assistance, a bit more bodies just working on it.
I think another thing I was going to say is we were just too early too. I mean, the Lightning Network was just spinning up when we started. So a lot of this stuff has sort of organically grown just for Lightning. Lightning has matured a lot. So I think we're in a really good place to push it forward now.
I guess I'm glad that you were kind of early because I would rather you be early than trying to do this in a decade. And so just doing the hard work, having it be kind of ignored for a while, I think is pretty similar to what Bitcoin had to go through. So why not you? So I think I'm pretty encouraged by this. I'm encouraged by the fact that hopefully some people will hear this and, like, oh, man, I need to get to work and help out Lot 49 and Richard here. But I want to go ahead and take a step back here. We kind of talked about all this, the kind of more focused on Gotenna and all this other stuff. I think you mentioned that other project that starts with an A.
Althea,
thank you. Yeah. So, those are probably the two big mesh network projects that I can really think of as Gotenna and that one. Can you think of any other kind of mesh network projects that stand out, or maybe just talk about the mesh network ecosystem generally?
There's actually quite a few. I mean, mesh is a lot like digital cash. It's something that sort of captured people's imagination for a long time. So there are various ones out there. I mean, there's one that I was just sort of revisiting today is something called the, I just forgot the name, but it's based out of San Francisco. I think it's called the Danger Radio or something. Yeah, Danger Radio, I think. I'm just looking up. But so that's built on a low raw radio system. It's got nothing to do with Bitcoin at all, but they're trying to build this sort of off-grid way for people to communicate in the case of an emergency, but also from the ground up. So that, that's sort of interesting. Other projects that are not strictly mesh related, but yeah, still kind of related to off-grid communication, is there's a lot of interest in creating this idea of low Earth orbit satellites. So not, you can see Starlink is one of those examples, but for sort of high bandwidth data. But there's a few projects out there that are for low bandwidth data. So it would be, like a satellite mesh. And those, this one in particular is Femtostar or Femto. Yeah, I think it's called Femtostar. And they, they're just sort of still spinning it up and creating a proposal. But I think they've got the great idea that you can basically do everything open source. So just like we're trying to do everything with mesh Gotenna for the sort of Block 49 network open source. They're trying to build an equivalent sort of thing, but on a satellite basis for a satellite network. So those are a couple projects that I've been interested in recently. But there's a lot, and there's a lot of technology for like mesh routing. And I mean, once we get into this, there's quite a lot of deep knowledge that we can tap from other areas, I think.
Just kind of looking towards the future, do you see the future of mesh networking kind of more like that we see the internet today, kind of just everywhere and ubiquitous and everyone use it, maybe even if they don't know that they're using a mesh network, et cetera?
Maybe. Yeah, no, that's a hard question. I mean, they've got this real trade-off between power and bandwidth. And, you know, I guess the vision I would like to see is so even though maybe say Gotenna is low bandwidth now, if you can bootstrap people to use this sort of network initially, you could imagine it scaling up to higher and higher bandwidth until you've basically got a bootstrapped mobile network, you know, mobile data network that's just like what you have now. But instead of paying T-Mobile or AT&T, you're paying with Lightning just other people who are around you. I mean, that would be the real ultimate sort of far vision, is that you could bootstrap a high bandwidth network, not just a low bandwidth network, that could be ubiquitous, that would take the place of the sort of centralized networks. Just like we talk about getting rid of the centralized banks, be your own bank, we could be your own communication network as well. And I think that's the far vision of what this could evolve into if people want it, you know, if that's what people want. And I do think that given the way things are going, both with banking and communication networks, that is something people will want, both for privacy reasons, but also just for sort of sovereignty reasons, to not have to deal with the problems they deal with now.
Not to go too far down this path, but do you think that technologies like Bitcoin, Lightning, mesh networks are going to disintermediate the state to the extent that they basically become irrelevant or redundant?
Well, that's the dream. I mean, that's the cypherpunk dream to some degree, is to disintermediate and get rid of, any centralization that is unnecessary. And there's definitely a lot of unnecessary centralization in our current society. Whether we get there in my lifetime or not, I don't know. But it's a goal. You know, it's decentralize all the things is a good mantra and something people should be striving for, I think, you know, when they can.
And then to kind of just close off the show here, would you mind giving me your kind of outlook of where Bitcoin Lightning is gonna end up in your estimation?
Well, end up, that's a big question there. But I think the current progress we've seen in Lightning, especially this year, is really a good sign. I think it's really picking up steam, and that's going to help with the more, just sort of last mile adoption of Bitcoin. And then on the other side, just sort of layer one Bitcoin, we're seeing other changes. I mean, Taproot is going to add a lot of privacy to a lot of protocols. And if we do end up getting AnyPrev out soon, I think that's going to also help with a lot of off-chain, not just Lightning, but other. We're going to just see other that I can't even imagine protocols built on layer two. I hate to say the DeFi word because I'm not sure that's really a good thing that we want, but we will see, you know, we'll see a lot of, whatever is useful as a second layer, I think we'll start to see happening more and more. So, yeah, I mean, I'm a bull for sure. I'm bullish on it. You can never predict the time frame for these things, but it's, you know, slowly and then suddenly, I think we're starting to see sort of suddenly in a lot of these things. Yeah, I'm optimistic. I mean, I don't think a lot of what we have right now going from a technology standpoint and a community standpoint too, just the development community, I don't think a lot of that's priced in right now as far as people's expectations. I think, I mean, maybe us, but just sort of other people in the world at large, I don't think they realize how far Bitcoin has come and will go. Really can't be more optimistic, to be honest.
Well, fantastic. I really appreciate you answering all those questions and joining me. Before we let you go here, would you mind letting the listeners know how they can find you on the interwebs, please?
Sure. So on Twitter, I'm R.E. Myers, M-Y-E-R-S, underscore. So feel free to just drop me a message if you want to talk or chat about this stuff. I'm also at I just created a website, so it's pretty rudimentary. But if you want to go to yakshaver.org, that's where I'm going to be putting up links about sort of the work I've been doing and what we'll be doing on Lot 49. And of course, there's also globalmeshlabs.org. So that's more a little marketing looking, but it has all the links to what we've built with Global Mesh Labs too. So that'll get you to the right GitHubs there. So yeah, those are three places.
Perfect. Well, Richard, I really appreciate you joining me on the Lightning Junkies podcast.
Thanks, Chaz. It's been a lot of fun.
Boom! That was the 48th episode of the Lightning Junkies podcast. I am hoping that this episode inspired you or gave you something to look forward to with Lot 49, Mesh Networks, Gotenna, all these things. Go out there, contribute to Lot 49, contribute to Lightning Network, contribute to something, you know, make the world a better place and all that. Don't forget that every Friday at 4 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. UTC, we will have a Lightning Network discussion on Twitter Spaces. We also had a very special Twitter Spaces on this most recent Friday, the 13th, where we had Rusty, Stefan, and others join us for the topic of Bolt 12 for podcast creators and content creators generally. I think this is a very important thing, Bolt 12, not only for me, but for podcasters, for content creators, you know, and that's why we had this Twitter space. You can find the recording for this episode on lightningjunkies.net or just by going to our YouTube.com/lightningjunkies. Other than that, I don't have too much else. Please support the podcast by listening to us on Breeze Wallet or any of the other value for value apps you can find at podcastindex.org. But that's it, you guys. Get out of here. What are you still doing here? I'll see you on the Lightning Network.